The pelican has always been an appealing and comical character. But despite its familiar face, we really don't know much about it. Here in Australia, pelicans do the most extraordinary thing. Every decade or so, some of them abandon the sea and journey more than 1,000 miles inland to one of the most inhospitable places on Earth. Much about their lives is a mystery. What triggers their remarkable journey? How do they navigate? And where do these long-distance nomads go when they leave their sanctuary? Deep in the heart of the Australian outback. The Australian pelican is big by pelican standards. Just to stay alive, a mature bird needs 4 pounds of fish a day. So it comes as no surprise that pelicans are found near the harbour. But what is surprising is that some are about to leave the sea behind and fly inland. An unknown force is drawing them to a place that comes alive maybe once every decade. An incredible journey across country that is short on water, let alone fish. So why would a water bird abandon an easy life by the sea and head into the parched interior of Australia, over 1,000 miles from the coast? They're well designed for their journey. With a wingspan of 8 feet, they can soar on thermals as well as flap their wings, perfect for long distance travel. And they don't travel alone. Many birds journey together in loose flocks. They spiral up, sometimes as high as 10,000 feet. And then they glide to the next landmark, traveling hundreds of miles over some of the most hostile territory on the planet. They can be airborne all through the day and into the night. The Australian outback is the driest place on the hottest and driest continent on the planet. Rain here is at best sporadic, and at worst, non-existent. It's the last place on Earth you'd expect to find a water bird. But the pelicans are here, and they're seeking the outback's most sought-after commodity. First clue that begins to explain their epic journey. Maybe they can sense distant weather systems, or maybe it's just by chance, but they arrive with the rain. This is the second year in succession that the dry riverbeds have turned into rivers, following the same semi-saturated route and filling quickly. But these waterways flow not the short distance to the sea, but hundreds of miles inland, toward the lowest point in Australia. It's this water that drew all the pelicans here. The flooded rivers are thought to be a kind of route map, remembered from journeys past, which guide them to their final destination. Pelicans follow a succession of temporary waterways, each with its own color signature that can be read like a color chart from high in the sky. Like all long-distance migrants, they need to stop and refuel. So although they'll pause at these temporary billabongs, they'll not stay long. There's something far more enticing in the desert to the southwest. But for now, they know that where there's open water, there's a good chance of fish. Armed with the longest bill of any bird in the world, the Australian pelican is a skillful hunter. The bill is also sensitive to vibrations, which helps to locate fish, even in murky water. A hook at the tip of the bill gives the bird a good grip on slippery prey. And to increase the chances of catching food, pelicans work together. They drive fish ahead of them into the shallows and then plunge their bills into the water, like a team of synchronized swimmers. It's hard to imagine that there was no water here just a few weeks ago. With the drought-breaking rains came not only birds, but also a dingo family. It's such a sporadic event, the pups experience running water for the very first time. Many types of birds are drawn to these waterholes, but whatever the species, they'd better beware, for some won't be leaving. Outstaying a welcome here could be fatal, so the pelicans are on their way again, to a place that's more important to them all. This year's rains have been unusually long-lasting and widespread, so inland rivers have penetrated deep into the desert. It means the flock can follow the water to where some of the birds haven't been for a decade, and others have never been before. And there's still another 300 miles to go. It's taking them to one of the toughest places on the planet, into Australia's fiery center. Heading into this desolate wilderness in the Lake Eyre drainage basin is Dr. Greg Johnston.
Here we are in South Australia. Out here, even though it's completely dry, you get this amazing sight of pelicans, which we'd normally think of as seabirds. But they come up here and they breed. One really interesting question is how on earth the pelicans find their way to Lake Eyre, and why do they come to this particular area? And there's a lot of stories around about the pelicans knowing exactly where they're going and knowing exactly when the water is arriving and knowing exactly when the food's available. I don't think that's true. I think they probably use the rivers as highways. They look like highways when you see them from the sky. They're lines of green trees in the red desert. And the pelicans can find their way around. These pelicans are moving 600 kilometres a day quite easily. They're very long-lived birds. And so these birds are thinking about this landscape at a scale that we're not.
But why would these birds want to be thinking about this place at all, when surely all they need is at the coast? To understand why, scientists are also looking at their stay-at-home cousins by the sea. Many of Australia's pelicans don't migrate inland. In this busy harbour north of Sydney, they live cheek by jowl with people. An offshore island provides some sanctuary to raise a family. Many pairs are breeding, with the first chicks already hatched. Some of their food is easy to come by. At 3:30 every day, come rain or shine, there's a free handout at the entrance memorial park. The local pelicans are a tourist attraction. Who needs to go fishing when all the work is done for you? Pelicans are highly adaptable and eager opportunists, so this well-fed population can stay here all year round. They seem to have little need to migrate inland. Yet huge numbers of coastal birds abandon the easy life and embark on perilous journeys into the desert. Their destination, Lake Eyre, is the biggest salt pan in the world. The salt is a foot and a half thick, and at 50 feet below sea level, it's the lowest point in Australia. It's blisteringly hot, and for 90 of the past 100 years, not a drop of rain has fallen here. It's a hell on earth, an unlikely place for a water bird. But Lake Eyre is also at the center of a vast drainage basin that covers an area the size of Texas, Oklahoma, and New Mexico combined. On the very rare occasions when it floods to its fullest extent, what was once an ancient inland sea becomes the largest lake in Australia. In a typical flood year, 100,000 pelicans arrive here, a third of Australia's total population, and it becomes pelican heaven. So important is the Lake Eyre population that scientists such as Greg Johnston closely monitor the birds the moment they arrive.
the reason why we want to find out what the pelicans are doing up here is so that we can know a little bit about how the deserts work, and in particular that's important if we're going to manage the water resources in the desert. We're here in South Australia, it's the driest state and the driest continent on the planet, and we're still learning how to manage our water in this area, and nature gives us the answers because pelicans have been finding water and making good use of it for many generations.
Lake Eyre floods to about 13 feet deep every decade or so. This is a decade year, and the survey area is so vast, Greg is forced to take to the air himself.
Hey Shane, how are you getting on?
Yeah, good thanks. Greg, yourself, mate?
Good.
Nice
Excellent.
To see you again.
It's great to have a chance to come out here on the helicopter because it really gives you a pelican's eye view of the landscape.
Yeah, so righto, mate. So anywhere in particular you want to look at, there's currently this is where the water is at the moment, all through here.
Yeah. Good to check out some of the islands on the south coast of Lake Eyre South as well. So that'd be a good place to go first if we can.
Yeah.
So there's three little islands just off the tip of that peninsula, and that's where we know they've bred before.
Righto. Well, we'll get out there and see what we can find.
Good stuff.
So the water hasn't quite filled the lake yet. Filling the lake only occurs every 3,000 years or so. Normally the lake's nowhere near full. Even in those years when there's a lot of water here and pelicans do breed.
So these are the islands we're after. That looks like it, doesn't it?
Yeah, it certainly does. Come out that way.
Yeah.
And you've got the little islands out here. Yeah.
With the flooding here such a rare and random occurrence, it's a mystery how the birds know when to come, especially from hundreds, if not thousands, of miles away. The birds may follow the waterways to Lake Eyre, but how do they know that the rains have fallen in the first place? Greg is determined to find some answers. The future of the Australian pelican may depend on it. For many of these pelican migrants, this place holds a special significance. It's where they were born a decade ago at the time of the last big flood. And now it's where they'll try to raise their own families. It's why they've all come, tens of thousands of pelicans arriving from all over Australia to breed. And here at Lake Eyre, conditions are just right for a bumper breeding season. This is a rare sight. The last time that birds gathered here in such large numbers was at the start of the millennium. At touchdown, the first priority is to find a new partner. Pelicans don't mate for life.